going to introduce the honorary members first that are all part of the goose hunt that's been going on here for 20-some years with Ron. And there's Tommy Fisher and Hop Singh, or Grant Kozak, are the honorary hunters. And the hunters that will be shooting will be Brian Prodal, Larry Wolf, Jim Warren, Brian Shepard, Jerry Hamburg, Connor Christie, and Colby Christie.
They're coming from the left. One, two, three, take them.
They're coming in from the right. They're coming in low, so take them. Here they come. Pardon me. High overhead. Take them.
But what a beautiful day. Surrounded by friends, warm, clear skies, a little bit of rain to keep the dust down. Almost as if it was planned. Or as Ron would have said, he called ahead. My partner Dave and I were home feeling pretty sad one night, and he said, "But isn't it great? Isn't it so great to be that guy, to be known as that guy who made so many people happy? So many people who cared about him and loved him so much. And that's why we're all here." He didn't just have that magic twinkle in his eye, but he had that ability to make everyone feel welcome. So welcome to the Christie Farm. We're all so glad that you could be here to celebrate Ron. As sad as today could be, let's share stories about the man that we all loved and that loved us all. Because today is truly about enjoying every day. And that's how he would have wanted it. I asked Jim Rickman last night, "What do you think Dad would say about all this?" And he replied, "Let's do this again." And that's just it. We never know when it's our time. So live every day. Ron showed us how to do that. And we can all agree that he lived a very happy life without regrets. Thank you all so much for being here, and to all those who couldn't be here and have sent their condolences from far away.
Thank you, Dana. Hunting, fishing, loving every day. That's how Ron Christie lived his life. Who would have thought? 6 short weeks ago, we were on our yearly fishing trip at Green Lake with Ron, and today we are having a celebration of life for him. On June 9th, Ron and I were reminiscing about people we have lost in the past, like Jake, Dennis, Bobby J, Dale, all good fishing buddies, and we're wondering who would be next. We sure didn't expect it to be him. I will certainly miss his calls, his sense of humor, his humbleness and appreciation for nature. One of his favorite sayings was, "It just don't get any better than this." I heard him say that so many times. For some of you who don't know me, I'm Morris Rivard, a friend and fishing buddy. I'm very honored to have been chosen by the family to share with all of you moments and memories of Ron's life. Ron's life started at this homestead. He was born November 25th, 1946, to Evelyn and Ross Christie. Their home sat over there where the corrals are now located. After his father's passing, Evelyn and the 4 boys moved into Marshall. Ron's life was always full of laughter, pranks, stories, card tricks, and genuine love for people he met and befriended on his life journey. As for those years growing up on the farm, Ron and Norval would both tell the story of how they were given a little red wagon to share, of course. They were both wanted their own wagon, so they decided to cut the little red wagon in half. Apparently, Norval got the front half with the handle, and Ron had to tie some rope onto the back half so he could pull it around. Well, needless to say, that was not their parents' idea of sharing, but they made it work. Brother Daryl remembers Ron as a prankster. He says, in my first year of school as Landrose, we rode horseback to and from school. I rode with Norval on Pride, and Ron rode his own horse, Star. One day after school, Ron rode ahead and hid in the bushes. He came charging out, whooping and hollering and startled Pride. Boy, did Norval and I have to hang on as we both bolted down through the pasture. Brother George, Brian George, known as both Brian or George, says that the story that stands out for him in his early years in Marshall was when he started growing his hair a little longer than the norm. Ron was somewhat concerned and offered Brian George $50 to cut his hair, and he did. But not being able to help himself, Brian George grew his hair back even longer still. Ron realized then that this wasn't just a passing fad, and it might take some time before Brian George would come around. Cousin Larry Christie recounts the following time at Marshall High School. When it came to mischief, Ron was the leader of the pack. One year for Halloween prank, Ron came up with the brilliant idea to borrow a few dozen straw bales from a nearby farmer at night, sneak it into the school. He said we had just adjusted the windows lock earlier in the day to look like it was locked, but it wasn't. So they're able to carry 60-pound straw bales into the classroom. Can you imagine now, 12 of them? Cut the strings and fill the room with straw. They said we had a few accomplices. The next day, we enjoyed some extra hours hanging out while the janitors and teachers spent their day cleaning. There was investigations to find out the guilty party. We were questioned as persons of interest. But it was, thank God, there was no DNA back then. As for lasting memories, Daryl recalls that not too many years back, a trip to Las Vegas for a Barrett Jackson auction, Ron asked a bartender at Mandalay Bay for a Caesar. She didn't know what that was, so Ron asked her if she had Clamato juice and vodka, and when she replied yes, he went behind the bar and made us each a Caesar. She was impressed with that his expertise on doing that. He's always been famous for pouring everybody Caesars. Had to have all the ingredients, though. These are Daryl's words to Ron. The highway only goes one way once. Give her shit and enjoy every mile. All I can say is Ron truly did live life his this way. I will miss you, our great adventures together. I'll miss our great adventures together. Brian George's second most vivid memory of Ron was their increased mutual interest in woodworking. As time went on, and either planning a project for the farm, or as Brian George recovered from his own illness, Ron was always phoning and encouraging him on upcoming building projects. For Brian George, these are memories I will always cherish and hold on to. I will miss you, brother. Ron made some lifetime friends during his school years. There are folks like David White, who Ron met at the age of 15 when Ron spun by in his car, gravel flying, and stole David's girlfriend of the time. David would end up being best man for both Ron's weddings. And Fred Holden. We're not sure if Fred was in the car on many times when Ron would outrun the police from Saskatchewan over to Alberta because the fine for drinking was only $29 in Alberta compared to $55 in Saskatchewan. He was going to save some money somehow. Probably outrun the cops all the time, too. However, Ron and Fred made many trips together, one of them being to Vancouver, Vegas, and L.A. in their younger years. Ron would be best man at Fred and Elin's wedding. And who was in jail cell with Ron when they were arrested for trying to roll a car? Oh, that was Larry Christie. How about Barry Brown? Is he here? It was Larry Christie and Barry Brown, maybe. That's time when Ron quipped to the warden who brought the food, "This is just like a picnic at Gully Park, but without the ants." Many of Ron's friends got to travel Canada and go pipelining with Ron in those late teen and early 20s years. Tom Voss was one of those early pipeliners, and he recalls those years and his time with Ron as follows. Ron is still in Ontario. He wasn't able to make it today, so he writes, I will start my story of Ron at 2 a.m. at a party to celebrate the end of a second year exam near the University of Alberta in Edmonton. In a moment that turned out to be a game changer in my life, Ron approached me and asked, do you want to go to Ontario in the morning? My answer was spontaneous, yeah. Simple question, a simple answer. Six hours later, on a cold and wet morning, I stuffed all my books and worldly belongings into Ron's car, never given a second thought to 1961 Meteor car I was abandoning in the residence parking lot. Time to go. Well, 2 days later, we crossed into Ontario, where a small town prairie boy who had never been east of Saskatoon, the Canadian Shield was magical to see. Rocks, trees and lakes, and all beautiful things, new and exciting to me. Our first stop was Kenora, which would feature prominently in my future, and after finding work on the pipeline, we then traveled to Dryden, Thunder Bay, Nipigon, Hearst, Kapuskasing, St. Catharines, and Niagara Falls. The entire summer was an adventure, and being with Ron, of course, there was never a dull moment. We can all attest to that. When I think back to that chance early morning meeting 55 years ago, it in so many ways changed the trajectory of my life. I can say without doubt that the summer spent with Ron was the utmost memorable and the best summer of my youth life. I think of it often, and I will always be grateful to Ron. I should mention that Ronnie and I were working in Dryden, and he met a beautiful young woman named Donna. He was immediately intrigued and soon smitten. I was delighted to see that their love story came full circle with Ron and Donna reunited later in life and sharing new adventures. Rest in peace, Ron. You have truly lived much more than most and impacted and enriched more lives than you would know. Ron and Donna started their married life in Lloydminster. During the time, Ron worked with an oil field supply company and then at Husky Warehouse. This would generate many friends and acquaintances. Many of you will remember the cross-country ski club, broom ball games, and Friday night parties at Carl Nygren's shop, and of course the weekends that never ended until folks straggled home on Sunday. You've probably been to some of them. It would be Larry Christie who started the next chapter in Ron's life by introducing him to Colleen Hiltz. Ron and Colleen married in 1976, and that would begin Ron's life as a family man. More of that will come later. Ron and Colleen's life in Big Gully area was a time of fun, love, laughter, neighbors, and of course the Lions Club. I'm sure the McEvitts, Gerard and Tom, the Tereshooks, the Holtz, the Kitzels, Dale Forlan, and many others that have many tales to tell. Perhaps several of those folks remember lending Ronnie $20 each one night at the Lions Club party. That was in Marshall. And that $20 turned into winning a North Battleford show home. Of course, that turned into one more big party before they sold it to show home to someone else. They had to party in it once before getting rid of it. Ron was always there for his neighbors and their families. He always gave a call to see how things are going and just simply check in on things, be it kids, cats, weather, crops, cattle, or whatever. Some days it was just stopping by for a coffee and a visit on his way into or from town. This is best captured in a Facebook post from Tara Holt. Here's the post. Dear Mr. Christie, oh, how we are going to miss you. I truly hope you know how loved and appreciated you were. Never have I known someone so kind, so genuine, so generous. You show the meaning of giving without expecting something in return. I will be forever grateful of you and to you for all that you have shown and given me and my girls. There's no one that will ever compare to our Mr. Christie. Rest easy. We will see you again someday. And of course, there was Rock and Ronnie's Hutterite Colony. Later known as the Colony. That was right here on this spot, complete with the Colony Lounge. Got the boat hanging there with the lights and everything. When it got 3 o'clock in the morning, you'd see each other. Linda and Norville, Walter and Joyce, and Pam and Sid enjoyed many meals, drinks, card games, and gardening with Ron over a number of years. Friends and family were always welcome to stop by for a visit and a meal. He was always so welcoming. Then there were the Vancouver Island friends and neighbors as well. Ron told many stories of his boating, fishing, and prawning adventures with Bill Wright and Wayne Frisky. Neighbors Casey, Jean and Kathy, and Jack and Joanne will reminisce about the block parties complete with white tablecloths and live music. Everything was always first class with Ron. If you're going to have an afternoon party, you'd hire a band, you know? And of course, there were those Friday night meat draws at the Sydney Legion. Ron was also a well-known and respected businessman. He and Larry McElkey started BMW Monarch on a handshake, a prayer, and a lot of goodwill from suppliers. Together, they employed many family and friends, and just a whole lot of good people. And of course, there were also those Friday night parties at the shop where everyone was welcome. BMW Monarch would become one of the largest employers in Lloydminster area. After 25 plus years, BMW was sold to Weatherford. And I was told yesterday there must have been at the peak, they had probably 700 employees. Imagine how many mouths and families that fed. Ron had three, make it four, great passions. Fishing, hunting, and both country and western music. When Ron talked about music, there wasn't country western, it was country. There's only two kinds. He said there's country and there's western. Springtime was fishing in the early spring, where there were season opener trips with Fred Holden and Dave White. Some of those turned out to be adventures in themselves. Every year, I had the opportunity to be there too. 30 years ago, for almost 30 years, they were an annual three-day fishing trip to Green Lake and area. Ron always joked that they had more music equipment in those trips than they had fishing gear. The evenings were always filled with music, card games, fish fries, lots of bullshit. Lloydminster bunch couldn't play crib worth a darn, though Bonneville bunch usually beat them. Also beat them fishing too. You had to catch their fish so they'd get their limit. Don Hutchison's over there, he'll attest to that. Throughout this afternoon, we'll occasionally hear fishing boys playing a few tunes up there. If you can stand the music, you gotta drink lots though. That's how we got through it in fish camp. We gave them lots of booze. Every year there was always competition between the boats, especially with us Bonneville guys. And as with which boats caught the biggest fish, the most fish, and on and on. And by the way, I didn't write this, by the way. This year, Jim Hiltz caught the biggest fish, and Ron's boat outfished the Bonneville guys. I gotta stress, I was at Green Lake. I was always telling Ron there's no fish there, but they did outfish us this year, and Jim did catch the biggest fish. That's the way the story goes, anyway. On June 9th of this year, Ron was on our last fishing trip when he took ill. GooseHunterRon@gmail.com. Doesn't that email address say it all? Fall days were filled with merriment, hunting from the hot tub, and more shenanigans at the farm. Jerry Hamburg, Jim Warren, and Larry Wolf made the trip to Canada most every year to join up with Hop Sing, or Grant Kozak. I pretty much know him as Hop Sing. Brian Prodal, Rick Lyons, and many other family and friends for that fall goose hunt. And I understand Brian Prodal went to the gather a few guys from the United States this afternoon so they could be here with us today. It's nice of them to come all that way. That's how much Ron meant to them also. Ron always closed out the season with his best buddy, Tommy Fisher. Ron would often tell the story of how he and Tom were out hunting one late fall day. Well, actually, they were sitting on the tailgate drinking coffee and eating some of Myrna's freshly baked buns when they saw a flock of geese fly by. Ron says, "Look at that lead goose," tipped his wing to he and Tom as to say, "So long, see you next year." Then perhaps Tom can tell you about the mishaps in the hunting trips in southwestern Saskatchewan. You see, there's always stories. I'm anxious to hear that one. Back to music, country and western, Ron's two favorite kinds. Music means party, party means people, and people means fun. Ron wouldn't have it any other way. In these late years, Ron and Donna enjoyed concerts showcasing Brooks and Dunn, Reba McEntire, Shania Twain, Louisiana Hayride, Johnny Reed, and of course, Willie Nelson. You could almost tell Ron's story, life story, using Willie Nelson's songs. Ron asked the Willie Nelson song be played for you all at this celebration of life. Nothing I can do about it now. Please enjoy.
I've done. I've got a picture in the back of my mind of what I've lost and what I've won. I've survived every situation, knowing when to freeze and when to run. And regret is just a memory written on my brow, and there's nothing I can do about it now. I've got a wild and restless spirit. My price through every deal. I've seen the fire of a woman's scorn turn her heart of gold to steel. I've got the song of the voice inside me set to the rhythm of the wheel. And I've been dreaming like a child since the cradle broke the vow. And there's nothing I can do about it now. Coming round the corners in my life. Leaving down to fate, staying out too late, waiting for the moon to say goodnight. And I could cry for the time I've wasted, but that's a waste of time and tears. And I know just what I'd change if I went back in time somehow. But there's nothing I can do about it now. I'm forgiving everything that forgiveness will allow. And there's nothing I can do about it now.
It's a great song, and you know, Ron never held a grudge against anybody or ever talked bad about no one. International travel, family and friends also featured prominently in the last decade of Ron's life. He and Donna started their renewed life together with adventures in Hawaii with Grant and Trina Kozak, complete with banana cream pie for breakfast and a missile threat from North Korea. Ron loved the Viking travel catalogs, and this was the base of his great number of his travel adventures. He and Donna took an 18-day river cruise through Europe with Jim and Janice Hiltz and Larry and Lori Christie. This was followed by a China adventure with Jim and Janice, and then an Australia, New Zealand Viking Ocean cruise with Jerry and Marge Hamburg. Who can forget the Vancouver Island Motorhome Tour with Daryl and Elaine Christie? Or the Gulf Island 75th birthday tour with Larry and Lori Christie. Life was always adventure for and with Ron. His best traveled adventure ever was taking his family on a safari in Africa in summer of 2018. Ron loved watching his family enjoy the sights, sounds, and wildlife of Africa. He delighted in hearing his granddaughters ask, "Is this real?" And his grandsons making calls in the long drop. Now, if you want to know what the long drop is, you'll have to ask Fraser and Connor. In a well-lived life, family was of utmost importance to Ron. Ron married Colleen Hiltz in 1976. Colleen's brother Jim remembers the first time he met Ron. In 1975, almost 50 years ago, this is coming from Jim. In 1975, almost 50 years ago, I was working in my shop when across the yard came this stranger. My sister Colleen introduced Ron, and within 10 minutes he was pitching in and helping me. That's when I knew I just met a guy that would fit in our family just fine. That was the start of a lifetime friendship. I was soon invited by Ron to join in on BMW Friday night socials at the shop, games of Mumbly Peg, refreshments at the Bar 5 Lounge, steak at the Trailside Inn, and trips to Edmonton to watch and bet on his racehorse. Soon it was fishing trips and holidays together, always fun, good times. When I first started farming, I would often have something break down. I would spend hours swearing and repairing. Ron went about it a little different. He had a different way of fixing his equipment. He could fix anything quicker than I or anyone could. How's that? How did he do that? He just go to town and buy a new one. Problem solved. To have been given the privilege to know such a humble, non-judgmental, and a fun guy as Ron, for as long and as well as I did, I would have to say I was a very lucky man. Often I wonder if Ron ever knew how much he meant to me, my family, and so many others. He was one of a kind, best friend. Ron's first experience as a father would be in helping Colleen to raise Rory. This time I'd like to have Lori come up and share a few words with you.
When I look around, it's like an archaeological dig around here. Not because of all the old fossils I see, but because of the layer of friends and family that are all cemented together through time with Ron. You know, it was 75 when I announced to my mom's family that Mom and I were getting married. To Ron, that is. From the start, Ron had become my father, and I watched how, like many of you, Ron worked hard to establish a good life for his family. Some people only see the success, but I remember all the hard work, all the late night call-outs, build a wellhead and hotshot it to some point far away in the middle of the night, in the middle of winter. You know, you just had to get things done. With some luck and a lot of fun, they helped forge a success that benefited so many. When my dad had first retired, I asked him, "Well, now that you have the means and the time, you know, why don't you travel the world?" And, you know, he looked at me confused and said, "Well, why would I go anywhere else? Everything I love is here. My friends, hunting, fishing." You know, I reflected on this often and when I made decisions about what I really wanted from life. You know, what is valuable? I think back and I remember how Mom and Dad, Uncle Gerard, Aunt Barb, Tammy and Dean, myself, and little baby Kimball. He was just a little guy. We all piled in the back of Ron's new yellow Chevy truck with a yellow cap, and we drove nonstop all the way down to Disneyland. You know, sliding window, and you know, I guess it might sound like a bunch of hillbillies with their homemade sandwiches and whatever, but you know, I was 8 years old and I got to see Disney. It was awesome. You know, Ron didn't care if it was fancy. He just always wanted to be with family and friends. As adults, you know, we watched as he shared the same enthusiasm with our kids. You know, whether it was impromptu miniature ponies or visiting the local baby animals, you know, he always found a way of finding the little things that made life enjoyable. I think some of you might forget that, or perhaps wish I forgot, all the shenanigans Ron and Colleen got up to here in the Marshall and the Big Gully days. The Bonds Beals, the Lions Club, the Marshall Dildos, the Winterfest, the outhouse races. Ron always had a way of creating or finding a fun time. You know, how many of us look back and remember the coin, the card tricks, the hot hands, the wizard? I'm pretty sure I've heard a few voices around here that sound a lot like a wizard. But anyways, we were all lucky to have had our times to share with him. And for us as a family, we're extra lucky to watch as he created those moments with our kids as well. You know, I encourage everyone to take the time, share a moment in the video booth. We'll have a video booth set up here by the other shed, and recall some funny instances, which we'll link together later. So, some of you here shared laughs and camaraderie, hunting or fishing. It never got any better than that, was the catchphrase for so many times out enjoying the wild. However, the wildest thing out there was usually Ron and his friends warming up a few times. So. One time on one of our annual fishing trips, we were at Canoe Lake, and after a hard day fishing, you know, Jake, Enns, Barkley Fisher, myself, and my dad, you know, we thought it'd be a good idea to sneak up on some of those big pelicans around Pelican Island there and maybe catch one of them. So anyways, we eased the boat around the island and, you know, ever so stealthily, like the premium hunters we are. And as we got closer, we could see the nervous look in their eyes as they saw these great white hunters come up on them. Anyways, so all of a sudden, they started getting nervous, and it was Giver. We pin her to the thing, and Jake's up in the front video cameraing it, and Bark's got the net, and we're banging across the lake, you know, shooting across like, you know, they had no chance. Anyways, there's a big old pelican, he's flapping away and you know, just having trouble getting off the water, and we're coming on hard on him. But anyways, we ended up missing him, but I don't know what we would have done if we actually caught one, but you know, we all ended up on the bottom of the boat. We were pelted by pelican shit all over the place, and yeah, it was just, but oh well. At least we had some beer to wash it down, probably, so. Yeah. You know, I always admired how Ron was able to cultivate so many lifelong friendships, and I think if there's a legacy for Ron to pass on, it is remembering to share a moment with a friend, whether old or new. You know, when I look around, I see so many people from 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, you know, that he still calls and knows, and, you know, knows your story, and you know, the troubles you've had or the successes you've had. And, you know, for us, you know, family events are always paramount with Ron. You know, one of his big wishes coming up was that he could have another big family reunion, and well, he finally got us to organize one, I guess, but unfortunately he can't be here to share it with us, but Ron always, for us, for our family, you know, the continuing legacy of Sunday suppers remind us of the bonds that we share as a family. You know, and it extended out to all the friends that we had in this community and around. You know, Ron always had a way of creating events to bind us together and in these common memories. So, you know, we thank you all for being here and share this moment with us, and I hope we can all find inspiration from his friendship and reach out and continue to share as a family and as a community. So thanks y'all for coming.
Should I read Alex's now?
Who's?
Alex.
Oh, yes, sorry. Sorry. Well, you don't quite get rid of me quite yet. One of our sons, Alex, is still traveling from Australia and, of course, battling with getting through the airports and trying to change things around. So he's unfortunate to be here. So I got a few words from him just to share with the crowd as well. So from Alex, you are currently, I think, in Spain.
Yeah.
So first of all, I'm sorry I couldn't make it today, Ron. After all, I'm not much of a morning person. But then again, nor were you. As you know, and taught all of us too well, life is too short for grand gestures and or any like that. That being said, I'll bet you're thinking about the whole event here at the farm today. It was those bastards throwing us a great party for me at my house, and they know I can't come. I've known the Christie family since I was 5 years old, and I felt like part of the family since day one, in no small amount due to Ron and his uncanny ability to make you feel included and part of the team. Though to this day, he still can't get my name quite right. Alex, right? Alec! He would yell across the table. I think we gave up correcting him on the 15th year. Some of my fondest memories as a kid were with Ron, waking up at the dawn in Lloydminster, hopping in the truck in minus 40 to go out coyote hunting. It's worth noting that in 10 years of this, we never once caught anything. Though it was only at the age of 15 that I realized that those coyote ribs, the ribs we served for dinner, were pretty hefty for a scavenger. And came in a box from the barbecue joint down the road. From these little moments like coyote hunting and chasing moose through the fields on the farm to amazing experiences like the time we spent as a family in Africa, Ron did for me what he has done for so many others who are lucky to know him, creating a warm and welcoming atmosphere that made me feel like a capable and genuinely worthwhile addition to any place, group, or situation when in his presence. Ron's passing is a huge loss for all of us here today, but knowing him and his effect on those close to him or anyone he met, he will continue to live on in every moment, every laugh, every smile, and every fishing trip for many years to come. Here's to you, Ron. We'll miss you. From Alex. All right, thanks.
Thanks, Rory. In 1977, while Colleen was in the delivery room, it seems that Ron and some buddies were all packed in a Volkswagen Bug that somehow rolled over. And on that note, Kimball arrived in this world. Kimball.
Thanks, Morris. Yes, that Volkswagen car. Gerard, Fred, Clancy, and Ken, may he rest in peace, were in that car with Ron. And if it hadn't been stuffed full of five pretty hefty guys, I might not have had a father to lead me through the rest of my life. So thank you for those guys being in the car with Ron that night when they rolled it. A little addition to that, some of you might not know the backstory, what happened the next day. So they were celebrating my birth that night when they went out. So the next day, when Rory and Ron came to the hospital to check on Colleen and me and see how we were doing, Ron said to Colleen, "Well, we had a little problem with the car last night." And Rory piped up and said, "He's lying, Mom, he's lying. They killed your car." One of the themes from today has been stories. And if you guys knew Ron, you knew that he loved to share stories. And sometimes he would tell the same one over and over again. especially if you're family. When he started into a story that we'd heard 20 or 40 or 100 times, we'd roll our eyes. And the only reason that he loved telling those stories over and over again is because they included the people that he cared about the most, his family and his friends. One story, and so if you knew Ron, it almost seemed like he could do anything that he set his mind to. He was very resourceful. Well, when I was in the seventh grade at Bishop Lloyd School, someone had stolen my bike. And I knew who, but I just didn't know where they lived. And so I got home and I told Dad about this. He said, huh. And he goes, well, hold on. So he gets out the phone book. I go, what's this kid's name? He goes through, makes a phone call. And he says, hi, is so-and-so there? Oh, this is him? Oh, good. Well, this is so-and-so from 1080 CKSA, and you entered into a radio contest, and you won the prize. We were wondering if we could come by and drop the prize off for you, if you could give us your address. So Ron hangs up the phone, and he says, don't ever tell anyone I did that. So we get in the truck, we drive over to the address, and sure as shit, there's my bike sitting outside. He grabs it, puts it back in the truck, and away we go. I never did have my bike stolen again that year, so that was a good thing. Another good story surrounding Dana was when Colleen gave birth to Dana. Well, actually, just right before. He was in the waiting room, and Colleen was in labor. And he took up chatting with John and Elga Rogers. And he got a little bit distracted and kept chatting. And finally the nurse said, you better get in here. Something's going to happen real soon. And so he's like, okay. So he went in. 3 minutes later, he walked out with Dana and said to John and Elga, said, see, it's that easy. Another fun story that Ron loved to share. In the early 80s, when we'd go to Edmonton for either horse races or for a weekend shopping trip, we'd usually stay in a hotel. And Ron loved ordering toast with peanut butter at bedtime for a bedtime snack. So it was pretty amazing that he'd pick up the phone, call room service, and toast would show up at your door. Well, Dana, she was about probably 2.5 or so. She thought this was pretty cool that if you picked that phone up, toast, you get toast. So she walked over to the nightstand at the hotel, picked it up and said, toast. And that's how you got toast. You know, I think Dad's greatest gift was being able to create and cultivate and maintain relationships. As Rory mentioned before, the people that he's known for 50 years that he still spoke to, you know, whether it was only once or twice a year, he kept in contact with those people and made you feel like you were a part of his life, and you were. It was pretty amazing. You all are proof that Ron was able to create and maintain those relationships. One of his good friends that we mentioned before, Jake Enns, that was a partner in crime if there ever was one. Ron and Jake, when they moved here to Lloydminster in the 80s, they started a bond that would go on until Jake's passing. And I remember with the Lloydminster Ski Club, when they were both involved with that and we needed a van. Well, Jake and Ron went around town to local businesses and they needed $18,000 for that van, and they had it by the end of the day. You know, Jake and Ron were both those kinds of people that could just, you know, hey, we need a donation for this club van. Would you be willing to give us some money? And they did it. The two of them together. It was pretty amazing. And I think another thing they shared was their propensity for bullshit. They loved sitting around and BSing for hours and hours. Ice fishing, ski trips. And another thing, including Jake and Ron, one night I had to go to North Battleford to DJ in a nightclub up there. and it snow was coming down, and this is about 6 o'clock, and Ron and Jake were enjoying a rum or a whiskey around the counter, and they said, "You're gonna go driving out in this?" I said, "Well, I'll go slow." And Dad said, "Don't do it." And I said, "Oh, I'll be okay." So I had a little Jeep YJ at the time, and the snow was really coming down, and it was heavy, wet stuff. And I got about a kilometer east of Lashburn, and I started hydroplaning on top of it. And I went this way, and then I came back this way and into the ditch. And there was about 3 feet of snow in the ditch. And I caught and flipped, did a barrel roll, and landed backwards. So I flipped the Jeep, and I landed on my tires, though. Wipers are still going. Engine's still running. And I thought to myself, shit, he was right. So I walked back into Lashburn, and from a payphone called, and sure enough, 20 minutes later, Dad and Jake were out in his Jeep with a recovery strap and towed me out, and we went back to town. One other story that I wanted to share was involving his other good buddy, Tommy Fisher, and my son, Connor. When Connor was about 2.5 years old, we were out hunting not far from here, and Connor was 2.5, and we had him out in the blinds with us. And Tom's grandson, Jax, and Fraser were also out there with us on that day. And Jax and Fraser were setting the decoys out there, about 7 or 8 years old. And Connor saw this, and so he had a soother with buck teeth on the front. And so Connor, he saw his cousins doing this, so he grabbed a decoy and he walled it out there behind him too. So then we got in the goose blinds and we had this pretty famous picture taken, and Tom just couldn't believe it. He goes, "Ron, this is the first time I've seen a hunter with false teeth and a diaper." And Ron said, "Just you wait a few more years, we might have false teeth and diapers out here too." I got just a little bit more to add from Tara Holt. She had added a few things to what Rory had said before. So this is from Tara. "I grew up across the road from here. I've known Ron my whole life. He and my dad grew up together, and they were school chums. From stories I've heard, they had a lot of fun together and occasionally found a little trouble too. Over the last few weeks, many stories have come to light about our happy-go-lucky friend and neighbor, and they all have a common denominator of one of a kind, full of life, always smiling, and there's no one better. The Ron we knew, who was Mr. Christie to me and my girls, was extraordinarily kind, unbelievably selfless, and had the most genuine soul of anyone we've known. There has not yet been a word invented in the English language to describe the level of his generosity, his hospitality, or to describe what a truly amazing human being he was. Over the last few years, he has given and shown so much to me and my family that we will forever be grateful for. The impact he has made on me and my girls was immense, and I truly hope he knew that. As many times as I told him how appreciative I was for him and his kindness, I constantly told him, 'You are far too good to me, you know.' He always managed to turn it around and make it that my kindness to him was somehow far greater. It was hard winning an argument of this sort with him. That was his constant selflessness showing. I don't think he knew any other way to be. The world is a better place because of him. He meant the world to me and my girls. The love and respect we have for him, and always will, is infinite. A man with a heart of gold. There is no one that will ever compare, and he will always be our Mr. Christie. We will miss you beyond measure, and rest easy," from Tara and the girls. To close up my little part, I want to go through some Ronisms, and there have been a few that have been mentioned already, and I'm going to challenge you to share as many Ronisms as you can tonight while you're chatting with each other. But one that he said earlier was, "She just doesn't get any better than this. Don't give me one of those cheap hugs. Just make the best of it." It costs the same amount to keep the top half full as it does the bottom half. If you don't eat, you don't poop. If you don't poop, you die. Well, you can't do something for nothing. I gotta pay you. Do you want an ice cream? And we'll figure it out. And I know for some of you, as you came in, you got one?
Let's get her done.
Let's get her done. For some of you, as you came in and we were getting ready to start the show, I know you wanted to say hi, and I'll get around to everyone, as many as I can, but I was troubleshooting because we just had to get her done. We had a problem with the PA, with the music, and shit, we had to fix it. Had to get it done. But anyway, I'm going to turn it back to Morris for closing, but thanks again for you all for coming today.
Well, in 1982 would be the arrival of Dana to complete Ron and Colleen's family of three. I'd like to call Dana, please.
Right close to the microphone.
Let's try this again. All right. I'm so grateful to have Ron as a dad. But our entire family was so much more lucky to have him as a paka, or grandpa. Come on. We were so lucky to be close to him the last 10 months on Vancouver Island. And that very first morning, he showed up before 7 a.m. to have a bowl of cornflakes with us. And every day, we could be sure to see him several times a day as he did his three-hour loop of the peninsula. He was always around for morning coffee chinwag, an afternoon interruption of David's work day, and to distract our tradesmen with tall tales. He'd ask, "What time can I get Ruby from school?" We'd say, 4 o'clock. We pay for the whole day. And at 3:45, we'd see his Jeep parked out front of the Deep Cove Market, and we knew that he couldn't wait to pick up his little buddy for ice cream. He was always on time, if not 15 minutes early. He was always someone I could count on. I'd walk out of school every day, and there he was in his Cherokee, talking on his bag phone, drinking coffee. He was always there when I needed him, big or small, unless it was diapers. He didn't do diapers. There's not one particular story about Ron that defines him as my dad. My best moments were with him just driving around looking at houses and buying buns. He loved the simple things. He was mesmerized by the joy in a slice of pie or, you know, potato buns, 6 for $1. Simple things, just like him. Didn't get any better than that. Thanks all for coming today.
And that's the story of Ron. Family, fun, hunting, fishing, and absolutely loving every day. Just got one little story that I can't... This is the classiest story that I ever heard from Ron Christie. And I couldn't believe he'd do, well, I guess he could do anything, but he took some clients and suppliers, I think some of them were Americans, to a northern lake, northern Saskatchewan. When it came to happy hour time, you know, 5 o'clock or any time during the day when you're fishing is happy hour, he asked one of the guys, he says, "What would you like to drink?" And he says, "I'd like a Caesar." Well, geez, he looked, and when I talked about ingredients, had to be every one of them. Well, he had Tabasco and Worcestershire, and he had ice, and he had Clamato juice and vodka, but he was missing lemons. Well, he said, "We can't have Caesar without lemons." He says, "I'll just give me a couple hours." He says, "I'll have them here." So he called a chopper charter, and he said, "Bring me 4 lemons to this lake." And 2 hours later, chopper come out of the sky, landed, and said, "Here's your lemons." He says, "That's the most expensive lemons I've ever bought." But nothing was too tough for him. I mean, like he said, just like Kimmel said, he'd figure it out, and he did that too, even right down to the lemons. So many of you gathered here today have stories and memories of Ron. To capture those stories, if you choose, the family has the videographer, Kim, who will be over by the woodshed to record your stories as keepsakes for the family. And we sure encourage you to do that. A while ago was mentioned, Rory mentioned it, but it's in the woodshed is just on the other side of the lounge here, the Colony Lounge. And, you know, if you have stories, please go share it with the videographer. He's going to video those stories, and that will be a keepsake for the family. So at the close of the program and with the opening of the bar, Fraser Christie will propose a toast to his grandfather. Ron was a man that touched every one of us in ways that were special to each of us. Many memories of him live in our hearts. In closing, the grandchildren are going to release balloons as we listen to a song by Johnny Reed that pretty much sums up Ron's view of life. Today, I'm going to try to change the world. Thank you for your attention.
My name is Dave Addy. I'd like to tell a little story about Ron. I was one of Ron's partners in BMW and came over in 1987. And at that time, BMW had four stores. And I came with a couple other guys and we started to build the legacy of BMW Monarch. And so we were doubling our business every year for the first 4 years, and came down to a situation that Ron and I had to go meet our local bank manager. At that time we were dealing with the CICB, and the guy was our representative, he's a little nervous kind of guy. And so Ron says, "Dave, you got to come to lunch with me. We got to get a bigger line of credit, and we're struggling here." So Ron and I off we go for lunch and sit down, and you know, Ron was easygoing. He was right to the point. We need more money. We need a bigger line of credit. And this guy just starts shaking because he had come that day to tell us that they're moving. Our account got so big in Lloyd locally that we got to move our account to Toronto. Toronto? Ronnie just flipped. "We're not going to Toronto. We want to deal with you. We're going to keep it. You just got to give us, I won't go into the numbers, but you got to give us X amount. And we need it now. Because we're already over our bank line of credit, right?" And we're moving and shaking, and that's when, you know, they're drilling 5,000 wells here. So Ron gives me a little elbow on the side, and he says, look over. And here's the the bank manager, he's got his crackers, and he's shaking so much he's putting them in his coffee. Ron says, I think he's a little nervous. So anyway, at the end of the day, Ronnie says, you go back and tell those guys we want our money, and we got our money. That was Ron. Thanks very much.
Heidi-ho, neighbor. It's the Wilsons. You've always wanted Wilsons for neighbors, and you finally had them.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ron's favorite.
Miss you, Ron.
Growing up with Ron, Ron made a great impression on this city. As the Christie name came up, I would hear the funniest stories of people who knew him back in the day. Ron was a friend, family, and entertainer. He always had a joke to share or a tap on what was happening worldwide. He always enjoyed entertaining and bringing people together. And I always enjoyed my visits with Grandpa because I knew I could expect a good meal, good conversation, and a card game. Ron to me was more than Grandpa, he was my friend. He was someone I could talk to about work, business ideas, friends, and women. He always seemed to have a good answer and something I could ponder later. Ron always had an expression in his back pocket, and one I was fond of was when he was talking about gas. He'd say, hey, Fraser, do you keep the top half of your gas tank full or the bottom? And, well, you know, the top half costs just as much as the bottom half. Ron was a person who always kept the top half full. And on that note, I'd like to invite everyone to raise your glass and make a toast to Ron.
Come along with me. I know you want to see a hunting, fishing, and loving every day.